Thanks everyone for joining us for this week's weekly investment meeting. Today I wanted to continue to go over a topic that continues to be one of the top concerns out there, which is inflation. And then also how that's starting to impact the markets, and in particular, gold. And then lastly, I'd like to end on the impact that it appears call option buying is having on the US stock market, which is propelling it into new highs as we close out the year, which is improving breadth, not just for large cap, but finally for small cap stocks as well. So here, what we're looking at is, this is from the New York Federal Reserve. This is a consumer survey that they do, and it's looking at expected inflation 1 year and 3 years out. And consumers are expecting inflation to still remain pretty, I would say, unglued at over 5%, almost pushing 6%. And even their expectations are starting to spill over into beyond 1 year. So it kind of tells you that the mindset for consumers is that they do believe that there in no way is this going to be temporary, but inflation will likely persist for a couple of years now, with their expected three-year inflation rate pushing to 4%. So the reason why it's important is the more that inflation gets entrenched in consumer mindsets, the more you'll see a change in attitude and typically in behavior. You'll typically see more stockpiling, attitudes towards cash being trash and keeping cash levels low. So this does tend to begin to impact consumer behavior if you start to see it entrenched. And that's why that three-year expected inflation rate at above 4% is pretty important development of late. Now, inflation being as high as it is, here what I'm looking at is an average for the G7 nations, which is shown in red. We're pushing over 3%, the highest in well over a decade, and how we tend to see gold follow generally inflation trends. So with inflation hitting a decade high, you would expect to see gold a little bit stronger than where it is presently. I think part of what's held gold back this year has not been inflation, but it's been a strong dollar, I think, has held gold back. When you look at gold priced in euros or yen or even a whole host of other currencies, the price of gold actually looks a lot stronger than what it does from a US perspective. And you can see that here. What we're looking at is the price of gold in over 30 world currencies. And we're looking at it in terms of different time frames. So the far left column is a one-day performance. The far right is a one-year performance. So over the last year, gold has been down against most world currencies. So what we can see from this chart is that we're seeing short-term strength in gold against world currencies beginning to spill over into intermediate-term strength, where if you look at over the last month, there isn't a single currency that gold is not up against. In some currencies, it's up substantially. Against the Turkish lira, it's up over 12% in the last month. In a lot of currencies, it's up anywhere from 3 to 5%. We're also seeing that spill over into three-month strength and six-month strength. And slowly but surely, we are starting to see some currencies gold up on a one-year basis against a few world currencies. So we are starting to see gold begin to strengthen here, which it are, as I mentioned, it's already been strong against other currencies, but finally it appears it's starting to strengthen against the dollar. And I think the dollar, again, as I mentioned, has been key for gold. What we're looking at in black is the dollar index, and in red is net speculative long positions in the dollar's percent of open interest. So it's a way to kind of gauge sentiment on the dollar. And what we can see in the bottom right there is that the dollar has been rising for the bulk of this year. And again, I think that's what's kind of capped gold's performance priced in dollars. But where we are right now in terms of positioning, often at times, this high level of speculative positioning, long positioning in the dollar tends to mark tops rather than bottoms. So that's why I think the dollar's performance or strength ahead could be somewhat limited, and we might actually see a turn in the dollar lower. And that would probably lead to a breakout in gold. Here we're looking at gold over the last year and a half, and you can see it's been in a downtrend since last summer. However, we're bumping up against that resistance, and a breakout in gold would likely see it at least retest its highs roughly just under 2100, if not exceed those highs. And part of the reason why is if you look at real interest rates, which are shown here in black and inverted, they argue that gold should already be near its highs. And again, I think part of the reason why it's not is the strong negative correlation gold's had relative to the dollar. But again, if we see the dollar roll over here, I think we'll get a sharp move higher in gold back up to its former highs from last year. The argument from real interest rates is there. And if you add to that a weak dollar, that really should be all gold needs to get a pretty decent move in the weeks and months ahead. Now, turning our eyes towards the stock market, one of the things that's just been covered extensively on the news of late, and I wanted to show this visually, is the amount of call option volume is surging again to record levels. I don't have a longer chart here, but suffice to say that when you look at the bottom left, the level of call options shown there in red over last, from 2018 to 2019, that was largely the levels that we had seen all the way back to 2010. So when you look at where we are today in the top right, we're orders of magnitudes above normal levels. And so what ends up happening often at times is when you see a big surge in call option buying, that leads to the underlying stock market being bought, or at least the individual names, as those who are writing calls will often buy the underlying security as a hedge. And so the greater the level of call buying, the oftentimes a greater level of stock buying or money flows into the stock market. So we can see that when we tend to see surges in call option buying, we also tend to see surges in the stock market. And so it's no surprise when you look at it recently, the big surge that came from the October lows is pushing the stock market higher. And this is leading to significant improvement in breadth. On the far left, we're looking at the Russell 2000 small cap index, which more or less has gone absolutely nowhere for the bulk of this year. It had a huge move in November, December, and in January of this year, but roughly in February, it started to peak. And at that time, we had a big surge in new highs, which was healthy. So that's why, for me, when I looked at that consolidation, I wasn't leaning towards small caps breaking down, but eventually breaking out, given the peak came with such robust breadth. And that's exactly what we're seeing right now. So as of Friday, we had just under 16% of those 2,000 stocks in the Russell 2000 hitting a fresh new 52-week high along with the index. We're also seeing in the middle panel, three-month new highs, new lows surging, as well as one-month new highs surging. And on the right, we're looking at the S&P 500. Breadth is still very strong there. You know, over 16% of the S&P hit a new high on Friday. New lows are absent. When you look at one-month and three-month new lows, again, those are pretty much absent. And so we're seeing pretty robust breadth. So it does tend to suggest that this market's got some more momentum behind it. It's broadening out. And we typically see, as I've said in the past, November, December are the two strongest consecutive months for stock buybacks. In stock buybacks this year, we're looking at annualizing $1 trillion. So there's still a lot of money coming into the stock market from corporations. And based on the call option and speculative activity, there's a lot of money also flowing in from the retail crowd. Recently, one of the people I've cited is Mike Wilson from Morgan Stanley. They've been in the corrective camp, even calling for it up to a 20% bear market based on peak growth. They're now tempering that correction call and delaying that based on the strength in flows. So even those who are bearish, it's forcing those to flip given the strength of how powerful this speculative move in flows has been. So I think we're going to continue to see strong moves in the market as we close out the year. And I think the next kind of big change, at least market-wise, will probably be to see precious metals finally kick in here. They've been largely absent in this commodity run. You've seen agricultural commodities surge, energy commodities surge, base metals, pretty much any commodity except for precious metals has had a pretty big run here in the last year. And I think we may finally see precious metals play a little bit of a catch-up. But that's it for this week. A little bit short, but I hope everyone had a great weekend, and we hope you have a wonderful week. And stick tuned for notes from our meeting next week.
That concludes this week's Financial Sense Investment Summary. If you have any questions about any of the topics discussed or about any of our personalized investment services, feel free to give us a call at 888-486-3939 or email us at grow@financialsense.com. Also, listen to our podcast, Financial Sense News Hour. It's on iTunes, Spotify, or on our website at financialsense.com.